going to play a suite that I wrote. We've been playing it every set, every night. It's good for us, you know. So it's the first time I've done anything like this, and it's been great to hear. The suite is based on a book called The Autobiography of an Ex-Colored Man, written by Weldon Johnson around 8 years ago, came out in 1912. And when it was published, first published, it was published anonymously because the book, the subject matter was considered very scandalous at the time. And I think it was published maybe like a week later than James Weldon Johnson, for those of you who don't know who he was a man of African descent. He was a successful lawyer, scholar, academic, playwright. He was an ambassador to Nicaragua and Argentina under Teddy Roosevelt's administration. The story is about a colored man who tells his own life story about a colored man who, from past to present, he has unusual social mobility as a result. It starts when he's, you know, when he's young, when he's sort of young, maybe until he's in his 40s. He's the son of a well-to-do white Southern gentleman. He's born in Georgia, and his mother is a black seamstress. The story begins shortly after the Civil War, going into maybe around the turn of the 20th century. He travels widely, becomes highly educated, he becomes multilingual, he goes to Europe, spends a lot of time in the South. He becomes a highly proficient musician in classical and ragtime music. And he basically kind of gives his assessment of the race question at that time by meeting various characters throughout his journey. Later he witnesses a lynching and decides that he would like to relinquish his life as a colored man, and he decides to live the rest of his life as a white man. And then at the end of the book, he laments that decision and then writes this autobiography. All right, thank you. So let's do it. Thank you. It may be said that the claim of the southern whites that they love the Negro better than the northern whites do is in a manner true. Northern white people love the Negro in a sort of abstract way, as a race, through a sense of justice, charity, and philanthropy. They will liberally assist in his elevation. A number of them have heroically spent their lives in this effort. Yet generally speaking, they have no particular liking for individuals of the race. By contrast, Southern white people despise the Negro as a race and will do nothing to aid in his elevation as such. But for certain individuals, they have a strong affection and are helpful to them in many ways. With these individual members of the race, they live on terms of the greatest intimacy. They entrust to them their children, their family treasures, and their family secrets. In trouble, they often go to them for comfort and counsel. In sickness, they often rely upon their care. This affectionate relation between the Southern whites and the blacks who come into close touch with them has not been overdrawn even in fiction.
Thank you. Thank you. Fuck.
A conversation with my millionaire friend. When I had finished, he put his hand on my shoulder. This was the first physical expression of tender regard he had ever shown me. And looking at me in a big brotherly sort of way, said, "My boy, you are by blood, by appearance, by education, and by tastes, a white man. Now why do you want to throw your life away amidst the poverty and ignorance and the hopeless struggle of the black people of the United States?" We talked for some time on music and the race question. On the latter subject, I had never before heard him express any opinion. Between him and me, no suggestion of racial differences had ever come up. I found that he was a man entirely free from prejudice. But he recognized that prejudice was a big, stubborn entity which had to be taken into account. He went on to say, "This idea you have of making a Negro out of yourself is nothing more than a sentiment, and you do not realize the fearful import of what you intend to do. What kind of a Negro would you make now?" I can imagine no more dissatisfied a human being than an educated, cultured, and refined colored man in the United States. I have given more study to the race question in the United States than you may suppose, and I sympathize with the Negroes there, but what's the use? I can't right their wrongs, and neither can you. They must do that themselves. They are unfortunate in having wrongs to right, and you would be foolish to unnecessarily take their wrongs onto your shoulders. Perhaps someday you will come to see that evil is a force, and like the physical and chemical forces, we cannot annihilate it. We may only change its form. We had slavery through a great civil war. Did we destroy it? No. We only changed it into hatred between sections of the country. To attempt to right the wrongs and ease the sufferings of the world in general is a waste of effort. You had just as well tried to bail the Atlantic by pouring the water into the Pacific.
observable.
Thank you.
is evidenced most plainly in marriage selection, while, on the other hand, the dark woman, I'm sorry, it is evidenced most plainly in marriage selection. Thus, the black men generally marry the women fairer than themselves, while, on the other hand, the darker women of stronger mental endowment are very often married to lighter complexion men. The effect is a tendency toward lighter complexions, especially among the more active elements of the race. Some might claim that this is a tacit admission of colored people among themselves of their own inferiority, judged by the color line. I do not think so. What I have termed an inconsistency is, after all, most natural. It is, in fact, a tendency in accordance with what may be called an economic necessity. So far as racial differences go, the United States puts a greater premium on color, or better, lack of color, than upon anything else in the world. To paraphrase, have a white skin and all things else may be added unto you. Once I heard a color man sum it up in these words: it is no disgrace to be black, but it is often very inconvenient. Sometimes it seems to me that I've never really been a Negro, that I have been only a privileged spectator in their inner life. I feel that I've been a coward, a deserter, and I am possessed by a strange longing for my mother's people. Small and selfish. I am an ordinarily successful white man who has made a little money. They are men who are making a history and a race. I too might have taken part in a work so glorious.
Yeah.